Hey everyone, it's Tyler Oakley, and today we are here in Cheney, Kansas, a population around 2,000 people, and I'm about to meet Aaron Mounts. Aaron is a high school senior who has spent the last 3 years trying to make a GSA at his high school. He's had a little bit of luck, not much, and so I decided to come here and see how I can help. Having a safe space to be yourself is vital, especially in a place like middle or high school where young people are just trying to find their identities among bullies, cliques, and social norms. Today, many schools have a GSA club, or a Gender Sexuality Alliance, that allows LGBTQ+ students and their allies to meet, make friends, and discuss issues tied to their unique identities. However, some schools are not so tolerant. I traveled to Cheney, Kansas, a rural community outside Wichita, to meet Aaron Mounts, a high school senior who has been trying for 3 years to start a GSA at his high school.
I'm Aaron Mounts. I am 17 years old and I go to school in Cheney, Kansas. I go to Cheney High School. I would describe Cheney as a town that is very close-knit. Everyone knows like what everyone else is doing.
What's the like reaction from the town toward queer people here?
A lot of people just simply ignore it. Students tend to like ignore that it exists.
I'm Jessica. I am Aaron's mom. He was always, as a child, pretty precocious, very intelligent. He's very outgoing and very sure of himself, very self-confident.
When it came to raising a gay kid in Cheney, what were some of your concerns?
Immediately, my very first concern was the amount of hate that the world was going to bring to my talented, beautiful, I'm gonna cry, son. Immediately my feelings went to how in the world is somebody gonna look at my kid and look past all of that and hate him for being who he is.
I want to start a GSA because when I went into high school as a freshman, you know, I realized that there weren't the resources for LGBT people at my school. I did some research, I kind of created like a small action plan, and then I just emailed my counselor one day and I was like, hey, so there's this thing, can we try this? And she was like, that's not really my place. And so she directed me toward our principal and I was like, all right, so I went and talked to him. And that's where everything kind of started. He was like, I don't really think we should have something like that here.
Aaron had been experiencing a fair amount of bullying, just going through, and we had just kind of worked with him to equip him to deal with that on a case-by-case basis. But it got to the point where it was affecting other people at school. Some of his friends who were not out. It suddenly was not about him anymore. It suddenly became completely unacceptable to him what was going on. And that was the day that Aaron sent me a text message from school and said, Mom, can you be here at 1? I have a meeting with the principal and I need you to be there. Schools are supposed to be safe places for kids. If kids are surrounded by people like them, people that are safe and affirming, people that are supporting them in living their authentic life at school and where they're spending most of their day, most of their waking hours during the school year, then that provides them the best place that they can have to really start working with each other and supporting each other.
Aaron told me that when he started the process to create the GSA, an advisor was required, and two teachers were willing to step up to the plate. Do you remember Aaron's first attempts to make a GSA?
So I had Aaron as a sophomore in class, and that was around the time when he was really starting that process.
Sure.
He went and, you know, talked to administration at one point, and I know at the time they weren't willing to make it a student organization.
I've seen other kids petition, you know, to go to the dance with same-sex partners or whatever, and then they got shot down, so I was, you know, I kind of wanted to shelter him too, because I felt like, oh, you might get shot down here, and I don't want you to be devastated if that happens.
I do think as adults we have a responsibility to help these kids. I mean, it's at high school level, it's a fine line between how much do these kids do on their own because they're getting ready to be adults and how much do we help them along. And with anything, a sponsorship of a group or in our classrooms, you're pushing them to be independent, but we have to be the ones that give them the help so they're not afraid.
Despite what you might see in TV shows and movies, the queer experience is not just in New York City, Los Angeles, and San Francisco. The reality that many LGBTQ+ people face is often more small town and rural, where your neighbors might not even think they know a single gay person.
It really needs to be a community thing. So when we have a town hall where anybody can come, it really gives anyone in the town an opportunity to come and ask questions.
I think when people refuse to talk about things, it lays the groundwork for misinterpretations or just a complete lack of understanding. I believe firmly that the first step in really affecting change is to actually put yourself out there and have those hard conversations.
I wanted to test the climate of acceptance in Aaron's community, so I held a town hall meeting at Cheney's Best Option.
We're here at the Big Red Shed. We're about to go out and do a nice town hall meeting for all these people that showed up today.
The big thing for me is I just want to open up a dialogue and say, you know, something that people don't often talk about is important to talk about, and that's feeling safe, loving who you are, creating safe spaces in schools, stuff that you've been working to do. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that doesn't get started unless you have those conversations with the community.
My piece of advice is don't assume anybody knows that you accept LGBTQ plus people. Because when an LGBTQ plus person witnesses you not standing up when somebody says, oh, that's so gay, or when they witness you not standing up when there's discrimination going on, that says something to them that, oh, that person's not safe. Oh, that person isn't an ally. Coming to this meeting and seeing you guys want to do something, to see young people that are literally going to change their town and change the course of history in their town and say, you know what, we are not exclusive. This is an inclusive community. This is a community where you are welcome. That inspires me.
The people that inspire me the most are the ones that aren't heard. It's the ones that maybe don't have the courage to come out. It's the ones that, you know, come out maybe as LGBT or even as an ally, because coming out as an ally in Cheney sometimes is not even the easiest. So it's the people who maybe can't stand up for themselves.
The adults of Cheney would stand up that are in support of LGBTQ, so the kids in Cheney that want to come out, they can put a face. They'll see us in the stores. They'll see us at concerts. So if you guys would stand up with me and say, yes, this is who we are.
I know that there are some of you in this room that it took a lot to get you out here. I know that there are plenty of people in our community that couldn't come out tonight or didn't feel like they were able to come out tonight. Being an advocate is taking a risk. It is something that I am grateful every single day that I'm able to take the risk. And I don't think I've been able to take that risk. For those of you who came out tonight, this is the first step. Don't stop getting uncomfortable. Start having those uncomfortable conversations.
And thank you to Glisten. So we just finished the town hall. I am so inspired by how many people came out and participated and spoke up and shown that they want to make this place better. I feel like, if anything, it just showed everyone in the room that they're not alone. After a bit of pressure, the Cheney High School principal agreed to meet with us. How would you describe the LGBT community in Cheney, or at least at Cheney High School?
Well, I remember Aaron sharing some information just about that there seemed to be some level of unacceptance, or I don't know if that's even the right word. We don't get reports of, you know, that happening and all.
It feels like there's a disconnect then, because from what the kids are saying, it doesn't feel like it's an emotionally safe place. And then from your perspective, you believe that it is. So how do you really reconcile that?
Well, I think what I see on a daily basis is acceptance with everybody. And I don't see labels on people to where, well, that group can't do that or can't associate here or whatever. I don't think it's a threatening place to come to.
Well, with the GSA, it can also help make the school climate more accepting as a whole, both through the administration and students who may not even be in the club. There is research that shows the school climate significantly improving with the GSA, because it really just kind of brings awareness to it. That's kind of like the importance of having a GSA at school.
That's a little beyond me. Our clubs that do meet all are connected in some way, shape, or form to it, to a specific or multiple curriculums. And that's what we do accommodate for.
When I look at a non-curricular club, I can't put a GSA in that category. I can see the GSA fitting into multiple curriculums, from art to the social sciences to history. And there are sponsors. There are teachers who are willing to be the sponsors for the GSA club.
Is there a world where you can champion a safe space like the GSA being allowed to meet here?
I have to keep the big picture in mind, you know. What's right district-wide, what's right building-wide, how best can we do that with multiple diversities.
So we just got out of the meeting with the principal here at Cheney High School. How do you feel it went?
There was just kind of a lot of talking around, not really answering the question, and just getting the overall vibe that he doesn't recognize that there's a problem here.
At the end of the day, it's just kind of denying the experience that kids are explicitly trying to share and to be vulnerable and tell, and then say, no, it's not a problem, therefore we don't need a solution.
Yeah.
Thank you and goodbye. Even though there's still a long way to go for this GSA, the students refuse to wait any longer, and they decide to hold their very first meeting on their own terms.
When thinking about what to do next, it's important to think about, okay, in an ideal world, what would your school look like?
Stories like Aaron's remind me that even in our country, the LGBTQ+ experience is not fully understood or accepted. But while there may still be a long road ahead, change can start from anyone.
Be vulnerable, be willing to take those risks, be willing to get uncomfortable.
While Aaron wasn't able to reap the rewards from years of hard work, his legacy will ensure that future generations of Cheney kids feel safe in ways he could only dream. Thank you so much for watching this episode of Chosen Family. If you loved it, give it a thumbs up, subscribe below, and comment with what you thought. For this season of Chosen Family, I partnered with one of my favorite queer artists, Adam JK, to create little one-of-a-kind pins to support LGBTQ+ charities. Here is this episode's pin. I think it is so cute. If you get it, the proceeds help support GLSEN. Thank you so much for watching this episode of Chosen Family. We only have one episode left, so go catch up if you're not all caught up, and I will see you in the next episode. Later.